I always feel a bit bad whenever I show this 3D printer in a video, because it's absolutely amazing, but it's also really expensive. So when Hagear sent over their new UltraCraft Reflex RS, I was really keen to check it out because it can print faster, it's higher resolution, and has a slightly larger build volume, but it's also less expensive. Because Hagears primarily make much more intense industrial 3D printers, they use that knowledge to make the professional grade Reflex, and now what I'd call this much more consumer focused machine. But also, the Reflex RS isn't quite a sequel, it's more of a spin-off, so it does some things better than the Reflex, but it also had to make some sacrifices. There's also new, less expensive resins coming out, different combo packages, early bird pricing, and I'm sure you've got a lot of questions and want to hear more about the specs. But first, I'm going to stop talking, let's go back in time, get it set up, and print some stuff. Okay, one quick thing that I really like is how the new cover flips all the way back. This is a bit different to the previous design, and I like how it gets completely out of the way. One thing that's the same though is how hard it is to film with all these reflections. The resin bottles are also the exact same as they've always been, and load into the back of the printer like this. Now, I know it's a bit hard to see, but if you look past the reflections, you can see the resin start to flow in. And this is PARP 10 resin that I loaded up, which they call their rapid prototyping resin, but it's also just a good all-round resin. Oh, and also Hagear sent over the new water washable modeling resin that I'll check out later on in the video, because right now it seems to be printing, so I'll see you all in 2 hours. Cool, now that the print is done and all the parts have been removed from the print surface, we need to wash it, remove the supports, maybe wash it again, and then cure it. And for that, I'll be using the UltraCraft Wash Station as well as the UltraCraft Cure Station, which are both available as part of the combo package. So, let's get to it. Hello again, if you've watched any of my previous resin printing videos, you've probably seen me perfect these tiny brick keycaps that I designed, so this time around I printed them in bulk. The only problem is that I didn't bother sanding down these little nubs where the supports connected, because I think when I put them on the keyboard you won't notice them anyway. These feel great, and I think I'm going to keep them on my keyboard permanently this time. Also, here are some quick notes I wrote down about the RS and my first print experience. Number 1, taking the prints off the build platform was super easy and much easier than the Reflex. 2, I don't like how the resin stays poured on top of the build platform when it's done. I'm not sure if this is a thing on other printers because I don't remember this happening on the regular Reflex. It's not a big issue, I'm just afraid I'll accidentally tip it all onto the ground when I remove the build platform. And number 3, it just worked. Blueprint Studio is super snappy and simple to use, the file transfer via LAN worked well, and the print process was just as flawless as it could have been. But those are just my thoughts from the first print, so let's do some more. Alrighty, here are 2 more prints finished off, and these ones were specifically requested by you lot in the last video. First is this miniature Bastion figure printed in a few different pieces, because I know a lot of you are interested in resin printing just for making figures for tabletop games and the like, and asked to see some printed, so here it is. And I don't know much about miniature gaming stuff, but the matte texture on these resin prints seems like it's perfect for painting. And it's worth noting that this was printed at the lowest resolution and fastest settings that I could for this resin anyway, and it's still really nice. Maybe the bird would benefit from printing at higher resolution since it's so small and detailed, but otherwise, when it's under a layer of paint or whatever, I think the quality here is more than enough for tabletop games, and it printed really fast compared to what I'm used to. And the other requested thing that I printed was the Millennium Falcon, which has over 7,000 bricks. I said challenge accepted, and then I printed the mini version instead. Sorry, a lot of precision is needed for these bricks to snap together firmly, and the RS didn't disappoint. Okay, before I print any more things, I'm going to do some more quick comparisons and dump a heap of info on you, so get ready. The RS is smaller, it's lighter, and Hagis say that the printing speed is up to 3 times that of the Reflex, depending on the resin and print settings, of course. The calibration is also improved, and it seems to start the print much faster than the Reflex. The RS has also removed the sluice gate, the part that goes up and down to allow resin to flow in. The RS still does have automatic refilling if you use the normal Hagis resin bottles though, because after loading that resin bottle earlier, I didn't touch it for the rest of these prints, so it must just be the pressure that lets the resin flow to the optimal level to refill the tank. I'm not sure, but it works. Other changes include that the tank is now mounted using screws rather than latches, and the build platform is also a bit different like you saw. And the most noticeable difference is the build quality. It's still very premium, but it's much more noticeably plastic. Also, I spilt some resin on the front and haven't been able to clean it off. On the previous Reflex, I could just wipe it off since it was smooth, but the new textured front seems to have just soaked it up after a few minutes, and I still haven't been able to clean it off. Please let me know if you have any tips. Those are the noticeable differences so far from my printing with the PARP 10. But Hagis have also told me about their upcoming PAS 10, which I don't have yet, but the formula is apparently identical to PARP 10. The only difference is that it comes in a cylindrical bottle without the fancy auto refilling lid, and it's also less expensive as a result. Why though? Well, like I mentioned before, Hagis primarily make industrial 3D printers for businesses, and businesses generally don't mind paying a bit more for convenience now and to save money in the long run, which is also why I believe they use proprietary resins for their printers. And the name change I also believe is to avoid confusion. PARP 10 is labeled as a prototyping resin because businesses would test using it and then use a more expensive, even higher quality resin for the final product. But for consumers, well, it's probably high enough quality already, which is why it's labeled as a standard modeling resin. So overall, in my eyes, I think it's a good move. I'm just glad Hagis is further embracing the consumer market, and I really hope they continue down this path and make their products even more accessible. For my next prints, I'm going to use the new PAR 10 water washable modeling resin. The benefits of this resin is that apparently you can wash the parts in water rather than isopropyl alcohol, the smell is less intense, and Hagis have said that this resin is particularly good if you're making figurines and miniatures, so let's give it a shot, and I'll also walk you through the slicing process as well using Blueprint Studio. It's really simple, just select the printer you're using, the resin, and the quality you want. Then you can just drag your models in. I'm a big fan of the one-click slice button that fixes the models if there's any issues with them, orients them, adds supports, and then spreads them out on the build platform. But of course, you can also do all these things manually if you want to. When I print my LEGO compatible bricks, I need to manually rotate them and then sometimes adjust the supports so that they don't get in the way. But for everything else, one-click slice works fine for my needs. Then I can just send the sliced file over LAN to the printer, and I can also send the recommended washing and curing settings directly to the wash and curing stations as well so that they're ready to go when the print finishes. And here are two more things. I didn't design these ones, but I've put links down below if you want to check out these amazing designers. And this time around, I washed the parts in just plain water instead of isopropyl alcohol before curing them. And there's no noticeable difference in the quality to my eye, but one thing is that I'm quite sensitive to the smell of isopropyl. Just a small whiff, even if there's proper ventilation, seems to cause headaches for me. So I might actually switch to this resin as like my main resin. I also sanded these parts down, starting with a rough finish and then gradually getting finer. And they look good, but there's still a bit of work I need to do to get them looking perfect. And I'm actually working on another video where I'm 3D printing some weird and wonderful community-made accessories for this new modular phone that I got my hands on, and these practical parts are going to be for that video, so please get subscribed if you want to see it. The next thing that I'm going to quickly take a look at is the UltraCraft Pulsing Release Module, which is a completely optional add-on that might solve some of my problems. It claims to be able to reduce print times by up to 25%, use 25% less supports, and also decrease the diameter of the supports by using high-frequency vibrations during printing. It isn't compatible with PAR 10, so I swapped back to PARP 10, resliced the same file for the Bastion figure to optimize it for the Pulsing Release Module, and then I gave it another shot. And here's the original Bastion. Again, I haven't sanded any of this. And here's the new Bastion with visibly far less support nubs. It was also really easy to remove all the supports from this one. This is cool. I thought the pulsing release module was going to be a bit gimmicky, but just have a look at these results. Now, I'm really lazy when it comes to sanding or painting, as you've seen, so getting higher quality prints straight away with no post-processing is going to be very handy for me. And now that I've done a heap of test prints, both detailed figures as well as more practical parts, here are my really quick thoughts about the Reflex RS. First, it's much faster than what I'm used to with an average of 7 seconds per layer, which is almost twice as fast as the regular Reflex, and it can also go up to 4.5 seconds per layer if you're using a faster resin like the Pore 10. Secondly, I found it much more reliable than the regular Reflex. I had issues with the tank locking in crooked, sometimes the calibration seemingly failed for no reason, and sometimes the resin would take like 20 minutes to pour in completely, but I haven't run into any of those issues with the RS. And finally, it's just a better deal. And sure, the build quality of the machine isn't as good, there's no resin level sensor, there's no sluice gate, and there's no nice latches or super beefy build platform, but I'm happy with the sacrifices that have been made to get the machine lower in price. And I think it's absolutely crazy that it's so much faster, has a higher resolution, and has a slightly larger build volume while still being at that lower price. At the start of the video, I said the RS is more of a spin-off than a sequel, but after using it for all these prints, I'm not so sure. Now, a quick little comparison, I own the Bamboo Lab X1C as well as the P1S filament 3D printers, and the P1S doesn't have all the features like a LiDAR sensor or hardened steel nozzle or a nice touchscreen, but I prefer it over the X1C because sometimes those features just get in the way. And the same is true with the Reflex RS. There's less features, but it's a better overall product that I have no problem recommending. Also, before you click off the video, there's currently early bird pricing and you can save quite a bit. The Reflex RS by itself is $799 USD, or as part of the combo, it's $1686 USD. I think that's a great deal, and if you do too, I've put some links down below. And please let me know if you have any questions. Cheers.